You know, they talk about how they're scared to go in the Army. Son, you'd be very lucky if you got that close. All I got to say is about one guy out of a million in the Army ever got close enough to get shot at. And behind that one guy, there were millions of guys doing feckless little jobs, sad, raggle-taggle jobs, very difficult to explain back home why they were there and how it happened. Well, I'm in a company one time. You want to hear about one of the saddest sights I ever saw in this whole, this great panoply of the war against tyranny and Hitler and all the rest of it. And I'm in this company. It's a Signal Corps company. Now, the Signal Corps encompasses all kinds of things. It encompasses movies. Did you know that? The Signal Corps units are constantly making movies out in Long Island someplace. We just heard a rumor of that. What a great job that would be, you know, to somehow be assigned to a movie unit. That was like Never Never Land. And then there were guys that put up poles. There were other guys that strung wires for miles. There were guys that ran radar sets. And there were guys that operated keys, you know, on Morse code keys. And there were guys who just sat in offices and took one paper off the pile to their left and put it on the pile to their right. And then reached over and took another paper off the pile to their left and put it on the pile to their right. And once in a while, off in the distance, a bugle would blow, and he would get up stiffly and go to the mess hall and stuff his face and come back and start taking papers again, up to the top and down to the bottom, hour after hour. Well, this is not my story tonight. This is not the story, the story of the company clerk, not at all. It's even, in a sense, a sadder one. I'm in this dynamic, modern, completely electronicized 20th century radar company. Now, you know, a radar company in those days... Oh, by the way, this is Gaunt Rockwell here. And this is your whoopee station, WOR, AM and FM, New York. And would you please, if you will, operator, strike the money button there.
Miller High Life, the bright new taste in beer.
Matt, you're an operator.
Miller High Life.
All the way, man. I can see you got the look
beer
in the eye.
There's only one champagne of bottled beer.
All right, let's go, Sparkling. King. Let's say it out.
Flavorful. Distinctive. Miller High Life. Brewed only in Milwaukee from a century-old recipe, Miller High Life has a rich heritage and tradition. A bright, clear taste. Unequaled, unquestioned, unchanging. Available on tap, in cans, and in the familiar crystal clear bottle. Miller High Life is always sparkling, flavorful,
Papa,
distinctive.
Pop.
Enjoy Miller High Life yourself. Yes, Miller High Life, the champagne of bottled beer.
Very good. I can't complain about that, George. You know, you've got the picture now. This is a dynamic, modern outfit. We have big parabolic reflectors. You know what is it, a parabolic reflector? Oh, you've seen, of course, movies of space exploration. Have you noticed that almost every SF picture these days begins with a shot of a radar tower? You notice that, Matt? Almost every SF picture, and they have a radar tower. I don't know why radar is constantly involved in SF, but nevertheless, this old radar tower, and some of that radar, incidentally, I'll have to add as an addenda here, some of that radar that they show in the SF pictures goes back to the antediluvian days of radar. They must have got it on a surplus deal from a Civil War radar company. I'll tell you, it's really ancient stuff. I saw one the other day. It says dynamic 20th century, 28th century or something. That he's got, oh, you see this radar going, oh, that was purely a museum piece. It was one of the first they used in the Battle of Britain, you know, back in the days when Winnie was a lad. Oh, and the radars go back and say, oh, wowie, holy smokes. Well, nevertheless, though, I'm in this dynamic, hard-hitting radar company. We've got little special insignia with lightnings and all that stuff all over us, and helmets with lightnings on the side. And boy, we're really a gung-ho radar outfit. We've got all the equipment set up there, and it's humming, and it's beautiful. You know, it's secret, too. Had a electrified fence around it. We're training. Everything is going. We're swinging. Right. We're the new dynamic electronic army. Men of the future. Science. All the rest of it, you know. Space. Flying aircraft and the whole scene. We were on to IFF, and we had all kinds of little secret numbers. Nothing gives you a sense of really being part of the future. Then everything you talk about is just merely numbers, like IFF 697/ANJ, that kind of thing. That's the way we described our equipment. Well, we were swinging along there, and everything was, just going hunky-dory. By the way, speaking of that, in the next barracks, right down the street from where we were, there was a very famous movie star. I'm not going to tell you who he was. It doesn't make any difference. He was in the next barracks, and he had played in a whole succession of gigantic war epics. And he was always like a colonel, or he was always like, a captain. He was being parachuted into Burma and all that stuff. And now, suddenly, he arrives, and he is a yardbird, raggle-taggle private. And he is two or three barracks down from us. And he cried day after day. He would just sit there and cry because he's in the Army. And we'd see him in the PX crying. His agent is on the phone, all the great deals. He's crying. He tried everything. I think he stuck ice picks into his ears and shot his M1 gun into his foot. He tried everything to get out. And sure enough, he made it. And about 7 months later, after he got out, we all marched down to the post theater to see his latest war epic, where he was a commando. He was a great commander. He had a helmet, with mud all over the... Well, nevertheless, here we are. We've got this dynamic radar outfit, and we're men of the future. When suddenly, without any warning, there was a big company area next to us that was not occupied. Another outfit moved in next to us. And they had wagons, they had big prime mover trucks. They had big, dark green personnel carriers. Boy, what a mysterious-looking outfit this was. And these guys had field jackets with no insignia on them. And we kept looking, wow, holy smokes, what is this? Some kind of an atom bomb outfit? A very secret outfit? But yet, they had sad looks. Every last one. They did not have the kind of sad look that guys get from just being in the Army, but really sad looks. Some kind of strange, mysterious, sad look, like they were doomed. Doomed men. And the whole company was just sort of walking around quietly. They would sweep up. You see guys picking up butts. And remember, we were in a restricted area where you couldn't just go in and what are you guys doing? Nobody quite did that. And for days, the rumors floated around in our company what these guys were up to. Their full complement had not arrived. And then one day, it arrived. A truck arrived with about 9 guys riding before it in Jeeps and guys coming back of it at a truck. And funny noise it made when it went past our company area. The truck itself made a strange sound, sort of like, ooh, ooh, ooh. There was something in that truck alive. Alive. Get this. It was not a horse. It was not the things you associate with the Army, Just something alive in the truck. Big covered truck, and it had curtains on the side of it. They pulled into the company area next. We're all curiously watching. Here we're dynamic looking guys with our lightnings on our hat. Our big radar set is going, searching the skies for hurtling aircraft. And these guys began to set up a whole row of pens. These sad, silent, lost men. And one by one, out of the trucks, they took Signal Corps pigeons. It was a pigeon company. A pigeon company. Do you have any idea how lost and sad and woebegone a pigeon company is in the middle of electronic wars? With single sideband radio equipment, with walkie-talkies, with all kinds of special long lines radio transmission stuff going and the radar going, hey, these guys got these pigeons, coo, coo. I'm not inventing it. Pigeons. And we couldn't believe it. The rumor immediately, we got a pigeon company next to it. This was like something out of the, it goes back to Florence Nightingale, the War of the Roses. It's like if a company of knights arrived, guys with maces, and they got helmets and big plumes on the top of their head, they arrived. You don't know what to make of this. The pigeon company, where are they going to use pigeons? And that was the hooker. Nowhere. That these guys knew it. They were in a dead-end outfit. They were pigeon men. And of course, they began to drift into the PX then, and we knew that the jig was up. We thought Up to this point, you know, they were some kind of an atomic bomb outfit. They're Pigeon guys. Pigeon guys. And here they are living cheek by jowl with this 23rd century radar crowd. Completely in the future. In fact, so much so that hardly anybody in the place knew what the word radar meant in the whole camp. And here we were dynamic, like missile men or something. And we'd go down to the old PX and these guys would sit around. I remember one day sitting there talking to a corporal. And he's sitting across from me. We're both having a sandwich. And he's from the other outfit. I says, Pigeon Company, huh? He says, yep, Pigeon. I'm in a Pigeon Company. He says, do you know what I shovel all day long? Yes, indeed. I guess I do, fella. He says, well, he says, you know the old expression, chicken? The old army expression? I said, yeah. He says, we don't use it. We got another expression, you know. He says, we don't only have an expression. We got the real thing. It's all over there. It's every place there. It's Pigeon Company. And so night after night, I would go into the Pigeon Company's area with other dynamic radar guys, and we would go up and down through the cages and look at the pigeons. You know, they had their special pigeons. Some pigeons were ace pigeons. There were like sergeant pigeons and there were corporal pigeons. They were, yeah, they did. They had rank. They were private pigeons. And each one had a signal corps ASN number on his little foot, you know. His serial number, you know, like a pigeon number 14-1722D. And once in a while, there'd be big excitement. A pigeon would go AWOL. They would take them out, and they would fly them. Yeah, they were always flying the pigeons around. And, of course, we were always threatening to shoot them down with our... Oh, yeah, it was one of those sad scenes. And we would watch these pigeons. They were going great, like flocks, I guess they call them. Up they would go, and all these guys would stand around, and they'd drive away. And whatever they did, they had maneuvers with the pigeons. I think they'd drive out into the boondocks and let the pigeons go, and then run back and wait for them to come back and cheer when they'd arrive, you know, and all that stuff. And then finally, one day, the word came, the Pigeon Company was getting shipped. And they were alerted now. It's overseas time. And they were packing their little pigeons into their GI cages, and they were putting their little GI overcoats and their little canteens on, you know, and they were putting their little helmet liners and stuff on the pigeons. And all the pigeon men were walking around in their company area with that stunned look of guys who've got the orders, you know, they're going overseas now. And the one thing we could not figure out is where was a Pigeon Company getting sent? Where would you send a Pigeon Company? And not only that, they were on a hurry-up alert. There was some fantastic, desperate need for a Pigeon Company somewhere in the world. And these guys are running around, you know, getting their shots and all. Whoop! In the dead of night, this secret Pigeon Company took off in a great big airplane and were never seen or heard from again. I still don't know where that Pigeon Company went. Did they actually use their pigeons? Do you know that there are several Signal Corps pigeon heroes? One pigeon that was shot down in no man's land in World War I and hitchhiked all the way back with his message, ducking from shell hole to shell hole. Yeah, do you know about that? There's a famous pigeon that is stuffed. And he is stuffed. I'm serious. He's got the Congressional Medal of Honor or something. I don't know. These guys were always talking about great pigeons of the past. Of course, they were involved in pigeons. And they were talking about great pigeons of the past, old Peg Leg Pete. They had names like that. And they had pictures of great pigeons and autographed pictures of pigeons. Sure, they were combat pigeons. Don't laugh. There were pigeons that were also on special detail, OSS pigeons. There were, I'm not exaggerating, everyone laughs, but this Pigeon Company, to me, was one of those sad moments that I've seen in my lifetime of guys who were involved in something that was totally out of keeping with the time in which they lived. No guy getting drafted, I'm sure, from Indianapolis who sees himself going up the beach at Anzio or something could ever possibly conceive of himself with a little broom, you know, with a going around. How do you explain that back home? How do you tell the chicks at the USO I'm in the secret company? And, you know, there's a certain aroma about pigeons. There's a certain unmistakable aura that exists around pigeon troops. Well, these funny little holdovers, these backwaters, these backwashes of great historical movements are lost completely, usually, in the histories that are written about those times. I doubt whether there will ever be a combat TV episode about a pigeon company. Have they done that? Really? You mean pigeons in World War II? Where did they use them? Where? They did, yeah, on combat. They had a pigeon company, huh? I'll be darned. Well, I'm glad to hear these guys finally got overseas. Then got, who got the stripes, though? Who got the DFCs and all that? Do they give a pigeon a DFC? Does he get a Distinguished Flying Cross? What does he get? I mean, does a pigeon get flight pay? Does it, you know, it's very difficult to, do you draft pigeons? Does a pigeon, is there a conscientious objector pigeon? I suppose the ones that that took off were. I guess there are still some pigeons hiding in the boondocks out there that won't come back. You know, they're waiting for the war to be over. You know, they don't want to get, but you know, speaking of the backwashes of war, a couple of years ago, you know, I've been seeing all these, I think in most cases, very badly done, atrocious, half-hour TV series about the Navy. Boy, there's some terrible stuff on about the Navy on TV. It's, if I were in the Navy, I'm telling you, you get the feeling that somebody's got to go with a hand grenade and do something on one of those sets just once. These awful things about the waves, have you seen those? They're really terrible. Oh, boy. But nevertheless, I had a very strange experience aboard a cruiser a couple of years ago. By a series of odd circumstances, I found myself aboard a missile cruiser that had been reactivated from World War II. This was a cruiser that was built back in the early days of World War II, had seen a lot of action in all kinds of battles in the Pacific, had been everywhere out there, and finally, after the war, it was brought back and stuck into mothballs. And then, a couple of years ago, they decided to reactivate this cruiser, take her out of mothballs, and put missiles on it, you know, the Terrier missiles and all that, and build her into a modern ship. And I was on the shakedown cruise that left Boston and took off in the dead of night, that hot, steamy, midsummer night. Oh, boy, was it ever hot, and the ship was shaking like mad, and it was kind of smelly, and they had just taken it out of mothballs and had cleaned it all up, and it was sailing down to Guantanamo Bay. Now, aboard this cruiser, it bore the name, by the way, that it had borne in World War II. Aboard this cruiser, there were thousands of engineers from the Bureau of Ships, you know, guys with a great big blueprint spread out all over the wall, and they were running tests on the steering apparatus and on the CIC equipment. In other words, they were running all the tests, the special tests that they run on a brand new ship. But yet it wasn't a new ship, remember. It was an old ship upon which new superstructures and new equipment had been placed. So we're sailing through the dead of night. We are now off the Virginia coast. Oh, it's exciting, you know, to be on a ship on a shakedown cruise and nobody knows quite now what it's going to do, and you can feel it shaking. Blah, 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 blah. The feel of a cruiser at night with that hot, steamy water going past, and once in a while you'd see a ship go off the starboard bow. We'd just go sailing across in the dark there, and we're all by ourselves, accompanied by a destroyer, on our way to Guantanamo Bay, and incidentally getting reports that there was a gigantic hurricane also on its way to Guantanamo Bay to meet us there. So we're heading into that night, hot, steamy night. Oh, boy, was it hot. And I'm in the wardroom. I'm sitting there with my T-shirt, sweating. Oh, the air conditioning wasn't working, and the ship was... because, you know, when all that equipment is going full blast on a ship, a lot of heat is generated. Especially when they're running it up and running it down and bringing the pressure up to the top and raising it and lowering it. The ship was like a floating inferno. And so we're sitting down there in the wardroom. Now, this was a wardroom that had seen a lot of action in World War II, plenty of action. And now it was being put back into use as a new mid-20th century missile cruiser. And I'm sitting there at one of the tables in the wardroom drinking hot coffee, trying to cool off a little bit and eating some ice cream. And this engineer sits opposite me, and he's got blueprints spread out all over the place. Boy, 7 yards of blueprints, and he's with another guy, and they're really having trouble. He says, "I can't figure it out, Charlie. This is beyond me. They're going over this thing with fine-tooth. They have books. They had spec lab books and the whole scene there, trying to figure out something that was not right on this ship. And here I'm sitting on it, and I'm beginning to get a little worried. You know, what's the matter, fellas? You know, I can feel the deck just rattling and shaking under me, and the bulkhead is rattling next to me, the cups are rattling on the rack back, and everything's rattling. I think maybe the thing, you know, maybe they don't know how to work it, or something. Maybe it's going to blow up or something. And so I asked one of them, I said, what, what's up, fellas? He says, you know, the very funny thing, there's a lot of stuff on this ship that does not appear on the diagram of this ship. That's what is up. Literally, there was a lot of stuff on the ship that just didn't appear in the official specifications of the ship itself when she was built and all this. The wiring diagrams and so on. I says, really? He says, yeah, now come on, I'll show you. And so about 5 minutes later, I am way down in the engine room. Now, have you ever been in the engine room of a cruiser? This is an experience. Or any large warship. It's not quite the same as going to the engine room of the Shalom or the engine room of the United States. You know, that's kind of like, it's like a showroom, these beautiful ocean liners. No, when you're down in the engine room of a ship of the line, that is business. And it is so crowded with guts, you can't turn around. The little tiny spaces, the whole crew, there'll be eight guys on duty down there working one piece of equipment, and they're all fitted in a space about a foot and a half square. Heat, smoke, steam, oil, sound, noise, pressure, vibration, it's all... You don't hear a sound. You cannot hear anybody talk. It just... And they yell at each other. You never know how they can... And they have earphones yelling, and you can't figure out, well, how does anybody know whether there's something extra stuck down there? You know, it's just chock a block jammed full, wires overhead. You see nothing but a tremendous sea, a beehive of cables, pipes, tubes, copper tubing, great asbestos pipes all over, bronze, everything. There must be 47 million spigots on a ship. I don't know what happened. I always had the desire to just turn on some, see what had happened. You know, little spigots and valves all over the place. Well, I am being taken down through this engine room, way down in the bowels of the ship, going through this hot, steamy, midsummer sea on its way to the shakedown area of Guantanamo Bay. And the guy says, now look, I'm going to show you this. See, now look at this up here now. He says, see? Now I'm going to show you exactly what I mean. He says, now here's where we are on the ship. He's got the blueprints. Now here's where we are on the ship, see? He says, now here, you see, these are such and such a lines. This is the low pressure lines. This is line. He says, now you see this line here. Now you see this one that's painted white there that runs along. It's all clipped there to the other. That is not on this blueprint. We can't figure out what this one is here. Why, right here. He says, see? I said, well, gee, you know, have you tried to tap into it and see where it goes, what happens? He says, there's nothing in it. Nothing going through it. There's nothing going through it, crying out loud. He said, come here, I want to show you something else. So he takes me all the way back, and we're following this line. It goes through a labyrinthine, all fantastic conglomeration of junk. We get back into another area down the engine room. I said, see, he says, it disappears there. It just disappears into the bucket. He said, there's a lot of insulation and stuff in there. He said, we'd have to tear out that whole bucket to trace that. I said, really? Oh, yeah. I see. Whoop, up into the wall. That's it. With a lot of other stuff. Wires, pipes, everything that goes in. See? He says, now, we've traced this. He said, we've tried it electrically. We've tried to trace it. He says, now, there is one other place where it comes out. And we go all the way back, and there's an engine room kind of a... like a little forecastle in the back. They had a couple of bunks, and he says, now it comes out here a little bit. He says, a couple of valves here, and then it goes back in again. He says, that's one. He says, you know, there are half a dozen lines like this on this ship. He says, now I'm going to show you another one. So we go down to another level, and there's one painted green. We follow this. We have no idea. He says, now it looks very, obviously this was put in at the time it was built. He says, it's there. You know, it's not just hanging, it's there. Well, that was the mystery aboard the ship. And we sailed another day. And finally we arrived in Guantanamo Bay. And oh boy, was it hot. The steam is just laying on that tropical climate. You know, you could feel that hot, fetid breath blowing off the end. It was laying there kind of menacingly, you know. This was at the peak of Castro's belligerence. And they had these big high wires all around Guantanamo. And off in the distance, you could see a few of the Castro-Cuban soldiers in a jeep driving along a hill, observing Guantanamo Bay and looking down with binoculars. And you saw a little Marine detachment on duty. And they had already sent all the people back. You know, none of the wives and the dependents were there. And this was a peculiar sensation. So we're laying there in Guantanamo Bay, and off our bow, there's a carrier laying off there in the mist. And you could feel the pressure from this hurricane building up. And everybody's walking around the ship getting ready to go out on the tests. And they're still trying to figure this out, but now they've just about forgotten. It's just sort of one of those things, well, you know, maybe the diagrams aren't real. Maybe the diagrams were not complete, so forth. Well, about noon on one hot, steamy day, aboard the ship came a chief. And this hard-bitten chief was one of these 30-year guys, you know, with stripes all the way up to his elbow and sort of a heavy-looking granite jaw, purple jowls, a real chief, you know, even the hat on the back of the head. And he comes aboard this ship. Of course, we're talking to him. And it turns out he had been on this ship during World War II and had come aboard her this afternoon because he heard she was in, and he had been honored during the commission ceremonies, the earliest days when the thing had slid down the ways, and he had been with her all through the battles in the Pacific as an EM. He had been a second-class seaman, then he'd been a, you know, he'd been a, all the way on up to a first, and finally he made chief, and then he was transferred off, and here he was back looking at his old wagon, you know, his old ship, and you could see the old tears in the eyes. He's walking back. He said, "I'll never forget the time." He says, "Fine, George, the kamikaze, we took a kamikaze right there," he says, "off Okinawa, right there." He says, "You see with those planks, that little roughness there?" He says, "I'll never forget, she was burning." He said, "She burned for over 2 days right there. Took a kamikaze." He says, "Let me tell you about the time we're down in the mess hall. We're all sitting down in the mess hall." He says, "I got up to leave the mess hall, and I'm walking on the way back to the bulkhead going up to the O deck, when all of a sudden," he says, "boom, something hit me in the back." And he says, "I just got one brief glimpse. I turned around and I saw this airplane come right through the wall there, right through the bulkhead, right into the mess hall." And he's telling us these stories. Well, I happen to be present. The exec officer says, "Say, listen," he says, "you were aboard this ship." He says, "Maybe you can tell me something." He says, "You're engine room, aren't you?" He said, "Yeah, yep." He said, "Old pipe fitter, yep." He says, "Can you tell us about what this stuff is here?" He says, "This was obviously here back in the days of World War II. And he's pointing out the piping. It was a kind of a silence. Kind of a funny, embarrassed silence. And the chief says, "Well, I guess, Commander, I can tell you what that is, if you really want to know." And the commander said, immediately you could see, you know, what's up? You know, what is it? Because the guy's whole air was kind of guilty and sheepish. He said, yeah, I'd like to know. "Well, you know, those are awful hot days out there, Pacific. So we were out there an awful long time." And the exec says, "What? Come on, what is this stuff? Come on, fellow, what is it?" He said, "Well, I'll tell you," he said, "we had 8 separate stills aboard this ship." And he says, "You're looking at the second section still there. The white one was for the second section." He says, "Now, the third section had a green one over." These guys had spent the entire war building an elaborate system of stills into this majestic cruiser that was out there fighting the forces of evil. And to this day, they're still there. And the exec says, "Do they work?" He says, "Do they work?" He says, "Do they work?" He says, "A matter of fact, we used to put about 4 guys ashore with DTs every month. Do they work?" He says, "They never figured it out." He says, "The whole war, they never knew where we were getting it." He says, "They had a tight security clamped down on us." He says, "They used to frisk us. They'd hit us in the back all the way. They'd x-ray us when we'd come ashore, come back." He says, "They'd hit us to make sure the bottles didn't rattle." He says, "We'd just come ashore, go back out, come." He says, "We never bought anything ashore. We'd take it out to the natives, in fact. We were selling it ashore." He says, "We had goods. We had that one there over there made bourbon. Over there," he says, "no, that was our gin line over there." He says, now down below," he says, have you seen?" He says, "Have you seen our rye, our whiskey rye line?" He says, "I'll tell you, it's nice stuff. We used to even age it." He says, "I'll tell you, we never drank it when it was a year old, you know. We were out there a long time."